everybody. Thank you for coming. Today we have the MPDA 18 inaugural lecture. We are very happy that Julianne came to make this lecture. For us, Julianne is used to be a very good architect. He's an engineer, but his technical background, he makes the material systems speak by themselves. So this is what he likes, his approach. He doesn't work as a consultant, but he's a brave designer too. Just making a quick summary of his bio, he finished his PhD in 2014, working in a dissertation on bending active structures in a PhD in a publication that now has become part of a benchmark, a reference book for all of us, and it's part of the master bibliography. And actually, it's one of the best layout pieces you can see. And it's not that common in engineering, so it's very nice for him. He has made some books, such as the Construction Manual for Polymers and Membranes. And it's those kind of brick houser thick books you see in the library. It's like the serious stuff on heavy weight. Well, he's been teaching in several places, but we met him through the several experimental buildings. He was doing a Stuttgart, and actually that just made for us a breakthrough in the academic world. He was pushing the limits of efficiency and coolness in the academic world. And some years ago, already 10 years, he established his practice. It's very important from him is that he's able to transfer all these experimental research into innovation in developments. So he's really committed to what he researches. He has a motto in our studies to not just speculate, but have a serious implication with our research. So now we leave him.
All right. I was asked to hold this, is that fine? Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Lydia. Thanks for the invitation. I think I'll start with having me here. I think that was like the nicest introduction I've ever had. I'll keep you alone next time. Yeah, he was mentioning we've been really busy in Stuttgart and several other universities around Europe and the world really, recently doing all kinds of material experiments and trying to find out how this material experiments can inform form and structure. And it's been amazing to see how in the last couple of years there's so many experiments came up in all this. I think the master course here at this university able to now dive into this new world. It is very new, it hasn't been around for very long, these kinds of courses. Now, what I want to do today is show you a little bit how the things that we did at the university, they taught us a certain way of thinking, a certain way of approaching specific problems. Especially for us as engineers, it's kind of been a real learning ground for approaching complexity in a different way through computational means. What I want to show you is that these kind of examples, what you see here on the right, that's our office in Stuttgart, that's one of our master thesis students who built this. This is what you kind of think of immediately when you hear about parametric design, these kind of modular systems that are informed by maybe local geometry, some boundary conditions, and material behavior, and they aggregate and become a complex system like this. Now, the way we use parametrics in the office sometimes towards things which are readably parametric design, but very often we use the means of parametric design, the tool sets that we have to optimize structural systems where you don't immediately see that this is a parametric design, so to say. So I want to show you a bit And it's open end after you studied here that you will, of course, all become experts in this field, but it doesn't necessarily mean that all of us will be designing things like the Office of Star. It can be deployed in very, very many different subjects around the building discipline. The first section of work I want to show you is where we come from as an office. I started as a young engineer working as a student with an architect, Bodo Rasch in Stuttgart. And with him, we were responsible for the engineering of many lightweight structures in the Middle East. And what we learned in his office is that with these kind of structures, it's all based on the communication between different design disciplines. So we, as structural engineers, actually sat inside the architecture office and worked on the same desk with architects to design systems like this, kinetic umbrella structures, which is actually the first project that we as an office worked on for Bodo Rasch in the Medina Piazza Shading project. These are 26 meters span umbrellas, and they're kinetic, retractable, they can fold. What's really important as an engineer to understand when you design such a system is that if the task is to build something that's not only standing the powers of the wind acting on the system, but is also be able to be folded, open and closed, and the pressure on designing something very lightweight, and where each cross-section of the steel arm is very thin and slender, is extremely high. Because if you were just to make everything as big as you want, you cannot fold it. So the pressures to design something extremely efficient in the kinetic structure are really different. And when you approach efficiency, today's computational means, it's very easy for us to simulate something very precise. So all engineers today have the software to make things very exact. If you want to get even more into an efficient range in the structural systems, then you need to understand more about the real physical behavior. As engineers, we make many assumptions when we start design things, and that's mainly on the side where we find what kind of loads we're connecting. So often we are very precise in engineering of the thing, but we're very unprecise in understanding what kind of loads are acting. So we will be sending models like this into the wind tunnel and measure very exactly how they behave. When you put a membrane model like this into the wind tunnel, in real life, the membrane is only 1 millimeter thick. When you build a 1 to 100 scale model, that membrane is built 4 millimeters thick because you have all the testing devices inside it. So you actually make a big mistake. And also that membrane in the wind tunnel will be stiff and not moving. So in this case, in this specific case of these highly elastic structures, like the membrane structures, to simulate it with computational fluid dynamics in a coupled model where you see the reaction of the structure, we call that fluid structure interaction. If you simulate like that, then you're actually much closer to the real physics of the structure than doing a normal test. So in this case, addressing this problem with such intense engineering was all addressed towards making the system very efficient, and that was actually the main thing that we have to achieve, to be able to build something kinetic in size. In this case, deriving the kinetics is a simple geometric problem. That's obviously something that's very easily included in a parametric design tool. And the reason to do so, and not to just derive the kinematics once, is because it is a highly deflecting system. So when this arm is opening, it is deflecting at the end under the tension of the membrane. So you have to define the kinematics in a way that is outbalanced by the free stresses of the membrane. So somewhere inside this actually sits a lot of reason to be addressing this problem parametrically, but the outcome of the problem, you don't really see that it is parametric. And even more in detail, we'll be looking again at this afternoon, when you address such a problem in fault finding, we don't immediately go into these problems by starting the simulation on the computer. We try to break it down into simple formulas, understanding what the force equilibria are behind the problem, so we can optimize them towards a certain goal. So in this case, you see in floor plan the umbrella structure. We'll be understanding it better on members themselves from the reduced budget. And these kind of initial thoughts are very important to then go informed into the reform budget and not just go by far. So what you can see here is these umbrella systems from the top. And you can actually see that it's composed of these large diagonal arms and the slightly shorter middle arms. And then you see these shorter arms that are also pushing out the membrane. These are what we call passive arms. Passive in the way that they're not linked to the central actuation mechanism, but they're simply connected by a hinge to these actuated arms. What happens now is that when we're unfolding the system, the membrane goes into pre-stress, these arms simply swing out. You can then understand that it's very important that the force from this corner points directly into the arm's direction, so it swings into its position where we designed it to go. And if you look very carefully at the picture, you will actually see that if you look at the edge curvature of the membrane, that you have a much less curvature here than you have on the neighboring span between the passive arm and the next passive arm. So you can actually read that we've played a little trick with the forces. Because in this system, so these membrane structures, force and form are directly connected. You cannot decide upon the form without looking at the forces, and we can't change the forces without having it react in the form. So these are actually very interesting problems when we talk about form finding, where there's this direct inseparable link. And when you start playing with the forces, you will see an immediate reaction. So we can't have some designing architect decide, oh no, but I'd much rather have them look all the same, because then we can't address this force pattern in a way that we have in more direct in the arms direction. You now get an impression of the finished structure system, obviously set in a gradient context. But even more so, it is important to understand that what we see here, the patterns on that membrane, are a simple decoration. They're also linked to the structural analysis in a way that if we have force concentrations down here in this low-point membrane form, then we address these by additional multi-layer membranes. And so the pattern, the design, and the engineering are connected in the system. And if you look carefully, you will also see that there's patches here that are directly located in the places where when we're closing the umbrella, when the hoisting system is connected, so we're reinforcing the system. So the first slide when I showed this project was lightweight design equals communication. You may understand from this project that in such a system, all the designing teams, architects, even people doing calligraphy and designing the patterns themselves, and engineers, of course, mechanical engineers, structural engineers, they're all talking to each other in a very intense way to design something together. When we design such systems now, not in an Arabian context with a budget that's obviously something that's rarely available in Europe nowadays, but we still want to build something retractable, the questions we have to solve are still the same and just as complex. We still have to talk to each other in a very intense way. We have to design systems which are very integral in the way they approach forces and form. And we have to also go beyond just the disciplines of civil engineering and architecture and talk also to mechanical engineers as we're designing the systems. So the next project I'm showing you is a retractable roof, where we immediately used a parametric approach to designing this roof simply to make communication cheaper in a way. Because one very big advantage of these parametric setups is that you can not only use it to generate the design, it's also very, very nicely used to control different design environments and bring them together on one platform. So that's essentially what we're doing here. We're looking at the geometry of the system, and at the same time we're looking at the structural analysis of the system and hold that back to one single design model. So now that makes iterations much faster, and we can design something to a high degree of optimization in a very short time span. When we talk about a parametric system, that doesn't only mean that we can change the geometry, but we can actually also change the tool. topology in terms of numbers of elements that we are looking at in the system. And so it's a very quick way of optimizing something. In this case, particularly towards the buildings that this roof is attached to. So the big challenge here was that it's a road with existing buildings, and we had to find a structural design that's optimized for minimal support reactions. And there were many iterations in terms of height, numbers of holes in the elements to understand how we can actually find an optimized system. Another thing that we tried out here for the first time is that normally when you build retractable roofs, you need multiple driving systems. So often you need something that can go far distance with small forces when you're retracting the roof. And then at the very end, when you're pre-stressing the membrane, you're putting with a high force on a short distance. And then often even a third element locks the membrane and holds it against wind forces. In this case, we designed something that's only controlled by one single driving system, which sits all the way in the back here. And the entire system is running on rails, which are usually used for robotics. So in the robotic industry, we have these super low friction rails that are made for heavy duty and even outside use. And so we could pull the entire membrane just from the very front corner plate, and everything else passively gets dragged along. Like this, we could reduce the complexity of the mechanics and the cost of the overall structure. And something like this obviously is only possible everyone from the very first sketch of the project works very closely together. when the entire model of which they designed the system already in a very early stage has all the information about the form finding of the membrane, the geometric boundary conditions of the site, the structural conditions from a very detailed analysis, and also the mechanical conditions from the just show you another project where we're doing something similar. So recently we've started actually building a lot of very small scale retractable roofs. So there's this market between the large scale roofs you see on stadiums and the very small scale roofs that we can buy just off the rack and use. And that in between scale there's a high pressure for efficiency to make something retractable at a low cost. And to reach that efficiency, you can do so by again, addressing it with such an integral model where multiple design iterations are always immediately an outcome also towards the engineering models and finally also towards the production drawings. And again, to stress the argument, what you see here is not generally understood as parametric design, but the background, the tool sets that we're using, and everything that we've learned from these experimental projects at different universities where we work, they highly inform the way we design these systems. So this is actually, nowadays, probably the most complicated structure we've ever engineered in our office, and at the same time, the smallest. To be doing something like that, obviously, at a very small budget, you can ask a lot when you build for this client, but you can never ask as much as for a stadium. But in terms of an engineering complexity, it's just the same. If you still want to build something like that, and you need to make the planning process very efficient, and you need to make them repetitive, so that the next time we design something like this, maybe on a different geometry, we can use the models that we used before. That's when it becomes more efficient. Now, something that I've noticed in working in the engineering world now on commercial building structures is that what we started doing at university was computational aided design, moving towards the kind of computational design era which we are in now, has actually made it incredibly easy for us to embrace complexity and to make to not be scared anymore, to be designing things which are incredibly complex in terms of their geometry but also their topology. And as an engineer, we now have also simulation models which very easily can be directly linked to the architect's model, and we can just simply import geometry and start simulation. There's absolutely no problem with that anymore. Only a couple of years ago, structural engineers would be scared to do a 3D analysis, to be still breaking things down into abstracted models. Today, that's the total standard. It's actually become almost way too easy to just take an architect's model and perform an analysis on it. But the question is whether the outcome of this design methodology that we're using now and the last steps in design, when we're actually turning it into construction drawings, when we're manufacturing it and putting it on site, whether we can actually address that with the same efficiency that we have now in the beginning of the design process. And I think a very good example is the BMW world in Munich, where you can see the architects having designed something that's not at all based on a modular repeating system, but is already addressing some complexity in the geometry, and where the engineers would have found it very easy to do a first 3D analysis of the system and size everything and bring it to the regular moment of tender. But then at the end, we're still relying on very classic ways of detailing, joining, manufacturing, producing the individual building parts. In this case, they even had to do so because they were under extremely high time pressure, so there was no time to design special connections, which also mean we need more time for engineering of it and also for the production of the shop drawings and the actual manufacturing. And you can see that there's a kind of break here, that something that's, and all of you would already now be easily able to use any of your CAD programs to design something like this. And very quickly, any engineer would be able to perform such an analysis. But then, only much later, we can start addressing the detailing problems, and that's when we actually are faced with complexities that we can sometimes not even solve with the means that we have at hand. So I want to show you two projects where we've addressed this problem in a very different way and kind of show you the consequences of the way we've addressed these problems. The first project was a ETFE roof that we are actually just finishing building now in the Austrian Alps. And the design idea of the architect, Architect Kuhalle, was to build like a light floating ETFE cushion roof on these branch pillars. We then took this design intention and worked on the further optimization of the system with extremely high flow loads in the house. Obviously, the structure inside the cushion had to be of much more structural integrity than was initially imagined. We had to add some bracing elements in it. And we actually split up the system into a multi-layer system where the lower membrane is cable supported. There's a cable mesh on top of the steel beams. And then we have an ETFE cushion on top, so that under high snow load, the ETFE cushion can simply stick down and then lie in the cable mesh when there's extremely high snow load on it. So it's a very integral system with a complex and bespoke geometry. Everything is different in the design. And we broke it down into both some geometrically and structurally informed in its form finding. So what we did is we set up a parametric model where the outer geometry is based on four intersecting slope beams and a form finding of the pillars and the membrane and cable meshes was immediately included in the parametric model. This model should be given back to the architect and he could then start playing with different boundary curves to kind of set his design in that given lava space where this thing is built now. The intention was to make everything then the steel work very directly aligned with the forces and the tangents of the curvatures of the system. So the edge beam was actually a very integral part of the entire design, picking up the tangential directions of the cables and at the same time integrating obviously the water drainage system. It had to be airtight, so there's a lot of complexity just in that one element. This will then obviously have an immediate effect on the production costs of such a system. If you imagine this edge curve is composed of four different bending radii in a very complex shape that need to laser cut and then form into a compound cross-section which grades all these different directions. So this is something that you can design, you can do, but it's off the norm. It's something that you have to then address with very specific design tools and also very early get informed about the way you can galvanize this thing and the way it can be produced, what kind of bending radii they could produce in their shops for exotic places and so on. More difficult, I'm just going back, would be these nodes where we have the pillars coming down, intersecting with these bracings and then going down to the ground. So what we're doing is we're sending the air for the cushion through the pillars, which means the air, the water, and the electricity is all going through the pillars. It means that at that crossing, they have to be hollowed. We can't be slotting plates into these crossings, because then we couldn't pass into the pipes through it. So the way you can address that nowadays, and this is actually a very old way of detailing something that's geometric complex, is by casting steel. And again, geometrically, we can address this with a parametric model, where we can pick up the boundary curves and tangential directions from the steel, turn that into a 3D surface model, and again, it's fairly easy to make an analysis model out of that, because we now have these computational means of making these models. But the effect on the production of this node is obviously connected to a much higher cost and a much higher work intensity. But at the same time, there's now ways to produce these which we formerly did not have, for example, by 3D sand printing. What happened here is the 3D model of the node gets turned into a negative shape. Sand is printed in the shape, and then there's some internal ceramic parts which make the hollow part of it. But the material that gets fed into this node obviously has all kinds of connections, and so the work after casting the steel is still quite intense. So it has to be sanded down, it has to be treated around the corners, and then only at the very end, when it's welded into the system, you get that final impression. Unfortunately, I don't have pictures of the finished project. It's going up at the moment, and I'm sure we'll be showing some images of it very soon. But one thing you can already point out here is that when you see this node in this connection, it seems like a very obvious solution. And this is actually something we're always hunting for. We're always trying to design things in a way where a person which passes by your structure doesn't even notice what you've designed. It just seems like a very obvious and not very loud solution. It doesn't stick out at you and show like, look, there's also technology here, look at me. It just needs to look like it's a totally integral part of the system. But to make things look obvious and make things look very integral is sometimes much more difficult than doing something that looks extremely complex. The next way I want to present how to address this is by means of what we call digital detailing. So what you see now is that we can approach the steel cast node with all the computational tools that we have. We can even 3D sand print, but it stops where this element is produced. All the information that we put into it goes into this production. And then after that comes a lot of manual labor, classic grinding it down, treating it, and a lot of steps of manual labor actually to then make this be part of the building structure. When we talk about digital detailing, we want to make use of the fact that when, for example, the steel plate is on the laser cutter, we can use the laser cutter to write things in the detail and then give it additional information that people can then later use for manufacturing and even during the construction phase. So we use the intelligence of the computational manufacturing to actually also optimize the processes after designing the system. This can be shown on a project that we recently finished, scan ETFP dome structure. Well, again, we have like a classic way design goes nowadays. The architects have designed a large dome structure, 45 meters span, out of three intersecting domes. And in total contrast to how we used to think about these dome structures in the times of Ahmed Spetula, making geometries that are optimized towards repeating geometries and modular systems to make individual nodes cheaper in production. Nowadays, we don't really think about that. We don't feel that there's any consequence to the way we design this thing. And again, to make a 3D structural model out of that, there's no problems connected to that. You can just simply take the architect's model and perform a 3D analysis on it. But again, here, consequence of such a design is that in this dome you have over 300 individual nodes that all have to address different angles of the beams that are being joined to these nodes. And the way we address this problem together with the architecture office of Stuttgart Design and Production was by this digital detail. So we broke down the node into planar plates, and we used a way of connecting the forces that is actually more known from timber structures, where we use form-fit connections, where we use a tube that slots into the hole, which in timber structures can very easily be produced through milling, and we're now using this technique to connect steel bars by laser cutting. And you can see here how the beams are connected at this node with these two disc plates. You can easily imagine that by changing the location of these holes, we can control the angle. They get connected by these steel swords, and you can imagine also how this angle can then be controlled. And because of the torsion in the beams where the two end swords are not always aligned, we additionally have the marking line here on that plate, and we use laser cut tubes with a laser marking on top where you can align that marker with that line, just to make sure that the people in the workshop do not need shop drawings. Because that's when these things are really efficient. When the people producing these parts, they don't need an individual shop drawing for every individual node, and they don't need to first cut out the node out of timber plates to align the actual steel plates and then start welding it. But actually, it really assembles like a puzzle. And then there's more details connected to this, which is, for example, tiny hooks that are connected to this to just make sure that during the mounting of the system, we are already thinking the way that it's going to be set up. So again, for example, in this case, later we did it a little bit different. The entire node can be connected without connecting the top speed meter. The design of that connection detail already thinks about manufacturing in terms of aligning the elements, and it also thinks about the direction of light. And further, we also integrate more intelligence in terms of the manufacturing processes into the numbering system. You can see there's these upstands welded onto the tubes. And we have an average of 3 to 4 upstands for every tube where the DTFP cushion then gets connected. The DTFP cushion itself has an individual frame with one position where it can connect to the steel tube. So the information that we needed to give the people at the manufacturer is at which location we need to weld this upstand. And to not then have everything resolved in the front, and then at the end we still need to give them a shop drawing or an Excel sheet to tell them where he needs to weld this. You can just simply use the last two digits of your position number and then say in decimal places that's the distance of your plate. So they actually started to think at the moment of detail about all the consequences that people later have to resolve to just make sure that the entire process becomes more efficient and then less costly. Small details like this, you can see here one of the two will be marked, and a tiny mark on that plate makes sure that you know where to put the plate. So these like small details, but they make all the difference to actually make such a system work. So at the end, what's produced is not drawings that show the assembly of the problem of each individual node, it's simply laser cutting files. And on the laser cutting files, you can now see we're not just sending the information of what's going to be cut, but also marking information, for example, show where the steel plate meets the tube, some lines printed, so to say, onto the steel parts, which then are the way positioned on there, so you have a way of measuring the distance between the two plates, so the quality of checking for their production. Because that's also something that we learn when you come from university, go back into practice, that the way we build these kind of systems in university, we say, hooray, now we have a laser, we can do 3D milling, do any crazy power, and we don't need drawings for it. When you go to practice, they want drawings. They want to be able to check, they want to be able to do a quality assessment of whether the parts they produced had the right length. So you need to find a way to address that without making shop drawings. In this case, case was simply by printing lines in here and giving them an Excel sheet to check the distance between these two lines and have them positioned in a way that it's calculating the number. Then actually also meant that you set up the system once with one particular manufacturer and one particular laser cutter. And you also have to make sure that this laser cutting also cleans this laser lens, because if you go through thousands of paths at the end, the tolerance is with a different lens. So these are all problems you have to deal with when you start working like this. Structurally, that meant having to deal with a whole new problem in terms of the detailed analysis. Because we were now looking at a node that's not covered by Eurocode, where we use a form fit connection. Form fit being that we don't have a bolted connection or a welded connection, but we actually just use the contact between the steel plates to pass the forces. To analyze something like that, you can do it, but it's actually, we say, computationally expensive. Our analysis runs for a very long time. And this couldn't have been done for all the individual nodes, so what we had to do is we had to find a way to calculate this node by hand with analytical formulas that we had to come up with, and put those into a parametric model to check every node against the 90 load cases that were used to analyze the system, and then only pick out from sets where we've divided the dome into individual clusters of loading, and from each cluster we took the decisive load case and nodes to then specifically address just this one node to do more detailed analysis. So you actually have this interesting thing that you're on the one hand using super high-end computational tools, but to make the process efficient you have to dial it back to very simple formulas to scan the field first and find out which individual parts we then want to address computationally and in terms of engineering. So we're going back to experts to finding out which node and which location is highly loaded. And this is then individually analyzed in an FEM model, where all the contact between the elements, the friction, and all these non-linearities are simulated. Today, using a program like ANSYS actually borrows the same scripting language and the same visual scripting style that we know from programs like Grasshopper. So what we can do here is we can split up that node into its individual components and send it parametrically into the model to make at least the pre-processing, the setting up of the computational problem for its analysis faster. But the actual analysis time to run such a system with all the non-linear context still takes the time of 1 to 2 hours to deliver a result. So at this point, we're actually very slow in the engineering of that node. And you understand that we couldn't have scanned the 350 nodes against 90 node cases for the entire system. mentioned earlier is that in such a system it's extremely important to think about not only the manufacturing but also about the site management and the way you erect such a system. So we designed this connection in a way that one of these individual beams can freely cantilever by only being connected through one of these teeth and a simple bolt that gets slotted through the end. So like this, it was possible for only three guys to build the entire structure. We had one guy managing the elements, one guy operating the crane, and one guy up here just sliding in all the individual cubes. Like this, they were very fast and ready to thing. One stage, close to one loop, they put on the outer plates, and then eventually finish the structure. This is some impression of the finished problem. These were the upstairs I talked about earlier on. The location is being organized by the position number of the individual elements. And you can see here also how the geometry becomes very individual in some part. And then you always have these kind of corners which are initially not part of the parametric design system. And if you don't take care of these in the beginning, it can take just as much time on resolving such a corner as you've taken on resolving all the other 350, because maybe you can't optimize this. So in the beginning, you already need to think, will I make this node plate in its diameter so big that even very small angles between the two beams can be addressed, which would only be possible by just making that node very big so that it can intersect. Or do I include in the parametric model the option of making a circle into a droplet shape? So I can address this problem later. Now, that basically means you need to go through this process in multiple steps of abstraction. First make a very simple parametric model and just check whether the way you set this up can cover the entire structure. Because you can be sure when you build something like that, there's always an odd corner with an entrance or some support which just cannot be covered by your parametric model. And as I said, it will take you just as much time solving that one corner as you have taken to solve the entire system. Some impressions of the finished structure. It's now in operation. It's the entrance hall of the dinosaur park. And the design idea was that it's actually the moment of intersecting cells and dinosaur eggs. Quick design idea, and then we had to deal with the consequences and way we dealt with it was parametric and computational. And I just want to dial back to the time when I first spoke to Enrique, when we built these kind of structures at the university, because there the design process was actually totally the other way around. You will be actually working here like this. You will first be looking at a material, understanding and analyzing its properties, and most of the time, at that moment when you're analyzing the material, you will derive an idea for the detailing. And then based on all these informations about detailing and about the material, you will start designing a system that is directly connected to the behavior of the material and of the way you want to detail. In the commercial world out there, we're not paid for detailing and materializing the structure until a very late phase in the process. In the beginning, when we go through the conceptual design and even design development, we're not asked and we're not paid for looking at the details of the system. Which basically means the way we address these problems at the moment, all the time at the university, is not at all mirrored by the way we work. So we're often faced with problems where simply the way things are set up can't be addressed with the way we look at these problems. And actually, the steel project I just showed you, the only way we could address it like that was because it became way too expensive to build it with normal means. And so the client and architect were open for new ideas to address them in a different way. It's only through this high pressure on the project could we kind of have a setting where we could go kind of new ways and address it in terms of problems. So some of you will know this project that was the first pavilion we built with Archimedes and Jan Kippers, two professors at the University of Stuttgart. I was a PhD at the time, and my work concentrated around the computational form the way this pavilion was built was based on the details that we could build, and on the behavior of the timber that we used. We derived the entire geometry in the rock, the entire way this thing was built was derived off of that. So here, in this kind of classic, or almost a classic way we build these experimental structures in the university now, would be, in short, to say material and detail first, and that will always design. Whereas, as I mentioned, the practice is actually totally the other way around. The challenge is now to connect these groups, to find ways to make things that we've learned here into practice. I will again also address this later this afternoon and show you a little bit how we also included very simple analytical ways of understanding the system into the learning paradigm. And again here, and this is totally similar to the UKP dome we just saw, once these things get put on site, the cutting pattern and the way these things are produced informs the production and informs the direction. So this is actually totally identical in process to the way this timber dome was built. There's no one here, and on the entire site there wasn't even any architectural plans. No one knew the exact measure and way this thing had to connect. It was simply by knowing the numbering system, which part gets connected to which other part. And the obvious solution by connecting them to these slotted details, and then the material behavior then created this shape. The last project I want to show is something I did here last year with the University Hamburg, the students from architecture and engineering. And something I've always asked myself when we work with these experimental structures is, how can we enable a big group of students to work simultaneously on one single model? Because what happened with all these structures that we built before is that we formed groups of people that were just doing material tests, some people were kind of organizing the project, and then there was always a very small cell of maybe one or two students who actually work on the computational model, just because the coding involved in one information model where it's not very handy to work on it with multiple people. So what we wanted to address here is, because we have architecture and engineering students collaborate, we wanted to find a way to collaborate also on the computational model. And we started off, like every time, with experimental workshops, understanding material behavior, in this case of textile hybrid systems, where we connect bending active fiber reinforced elements to form active mechanical pre-stretched membranes, and just finding out in a very free and undeformed way what kind of equilibrium shapes we can derive. There was a design competition that we made where groups of students could propose something for the entrance hall of the HCU University in Hamburg. And the design brief was that we had individual places on the ceilings where we could connect our structure, where there's hooks on the ceiling, so the places where we can connect it were given. It had to be conformed with the fire safety system of the building, which was actually very, very big. Big boundary condition to handle, because these are all the smoke exhaust windows, and they were like that in a very gentle place. And also, we had the idea that we wanted the design to somehow speak by itself about the fact that it's not intuitively built, but that it's informed by its material behavior, and that there should be some part in the design that we can read whether form finding or that was a success or not. So this student group had the idea that they wanted to build two individual membrane shapes that are structurally totally separated from each other. And both of them had one high point which pointed towards each other, and they wanted it to be perfectly parallel in the line after pre-stressing the system, even though they're structurally not connected. So this was their way of checking after installation whether we've done this job. Pressure was high that we had to achieve this. And again, we started then with more model building to understand the topology, understand the way material behaves in this hybrid composition. and simply finding out how to create this kind of floating high points where you create a high point in your memory system without pulling it, like pushing it through the memory active terms. The models became more detailed, you did models with cutting patterns, and larger to just make sure that what you were designing, what you were starting to simulate, you make reduction drawings out of it, where you actually get an equilibrium system that's somewhat similar to what we were designing. And as I mentioned in the beginning, this was all set around the challenge that I did not want in this case to have just one or two students do the computational models and all the rest, because organization and tests around it, I wanted them to all work together. So we had to, from the start, just come up with a model of making a centralized information model that works in different versions. Now there's many tools out there. We used Flux to connect the information model on the cloud. And the idea was that we have the way the information model is set up is in a tree structure that you can use to the information model inside Grasshopper. And we had a dedicated location for each information of the system in one of the branches of the tree, and it has to stay conformed to that tree structure throughout every computational model that we use. So like this, we could split up the model and have some people work on the detailing of it, other people on the structural analysis of it, other people just on the design and on the initial form analysis. And then by versioning this, people who were working on the detailing of the problem, they could simply load the geometry either from the initial design or from already defined the compound design of the engineers. And that would just change locally a little bit the geometries they were designing on, but not the structure of the problem. Now this is relatively easy when you do it on one fixed topology. When you know the number of arms you have, when you know the number of high points you have in the system, when you know the topology will not change, it's just the angles or the length of the arms. It becomes a totally different game when you say topology can also change. Then your numbering system has an open, but you need to be able to then say, I'm not solving a problem on that fixed location with that fixed number, but I'm solving the detail of the corner paper, for example, and any corner that has a certain hierarchy or a certain position number. So these were the kind of challenges that we tried to address here. And so we set up a model, we call it the centralized information model, cloud-based, and we fed the information through simple form timing to write memory into it, through more complex analysis using temporal history. We did some detailing, also principles of digital detailing was connected to the model, and we did the entire management of the project connected to it. So all the lists of parts that we had to order and the initial cost estimates that we did were connected to this model. And so everyone on this campus had this input where the tree structure was read out, and then you could simply grab parts of that tree which you could perform an analysis on. The project was supported by a white architecture from Sweden, Jonas Ingberger, who's worked a lot on making finding an organizational way to do parametric design. Because he noticed that same problem, often in these parametric setups, there's one individual person that creates a parametric model or something, that passes his own thing out. Close to impossible for the other person to understand the model. So they came up with a way of labeling things, of organizing things, which would always be the same, so that the models would be very structured and people can share these models and immediately understand where's input, where's form finding, where's variables. And for example, marked with a red group of a different shape, this is what we come to work with. By doing this visual script, you then enable multiple people to run this. A showed initially on that Medina umbrella, and I explained to you how the edge forces were resolved in that umbrella. This was included in the script here, where we controlled all the resulting forces along the edge of the membrane, and optimized them towards a direction which was connected to this were multiple material tests. Also, the cables that we used to tension the structure. We used Dyneema as a very stiff cable. This cable has enough stretch to not just be able to have you cut the geometric length, but we had to cut the compensated length by reading out the forces from the model and then looking at the threshold of the cable. We had to understand the threshold of the cable and then connect that to our analysis model. And here, one of the most critical things was that the hooks that we were connecting to on the ceiling were actually very thin steel plates. And one of the engineering groups had analyzed how much force we can induce here. And multiple design iterations just dealt with bringing the forces also under internal wind loads to a level where we can rip off these little steel plates from the ceiling. The way we can optimize it is just by changing the geometry, by dialing down the size of the structure, and changing the angles of the elements, and by putting all this discipline in the system. So the material was measured, we need to know that exactly the stiffness of the glass fiber and the plastic box that we need to make, and then check those against the plastic structure and also the membrane. It was tested, they have their own bi-axial test now, measure the material. The material itself was actually the biggest problem. We had to use a material fire rating K2. And for most membranes, we only get a fire rating B1. And so we were left with only one or two materials to choose from. In this case, it was just a molten woven glass fiber mesh. And this mesh has absolutely no stretch. But all of the structures we previously built were sometimes built with knitted fabrics that have really, really high strength. High strain. So even if the cutting pattern is mostly wrong, after installation you can see it. It's so stretchy material. In this case, absolutely completely unforgiving because it's a non-coated glass fiber mesh. And we did also see that in the end, even though we tried to do all the cutting patterns very precisely, there were actually quite some significant wrinkles in our structure. Also, the principles of this digital detailing were used here because the glass fiber rods that are connected to these high points, they all arrive at different angles. So we build these connection plates in a way that compensate for these different angles. It was also produced at the university. Initially, we wanted a commercial membrane manufacturer to be able to scale. When you saw the shape and the material you wanted to use, can't do that. And actually that was made quite lucky because then that forced us to organize the same way that we come to the university and we produce them together with the students. So it's actually quite a significantly large membrane with in some 70 square meters. So it's not like a tiny little structure, actually quite some significant amount of material and very difficult in handling. All the problems that can occur, probably do occur, and it's quite interesting, you can, with all our commercial projects and the university projects, every time, at least in some part of it, a problem that the entire numbering system is beautifully laid out, gets produced, and then either during the milling, some tipper parts chip off and then you can't read the number, through the laser cutting, after galvanization, you can't read out the number. It is always. So whatever you do here, make that mistake once and then try and resolve it. Because at the end, you have a puzzle and you try to find out what is that, where does it go? Right? And if you have also 100 parts, then it will be very painful. And this was actually a very cool moment. The only way we could set up this thing was again by laying it down on the floor. And we had installed a pulley system already half a year before we were wrecking the structure. That was the moment when they were cleaning the cylinders up here. equilibrium system in itself work. We truly have these two aligning rings where these two high points of the system met. And what was beautiful about it is that we were not able to correct that during the installation. The only thing we could do is pull the cables to their position at which we had designed them. You can also see that there's a couple of wrinkles here on the membrane when you're sewing such a glass fiber textile that it goes. It's extremely difficult to handle. But for us to see that these things are aligning like that, that was the one at least some of them are part of our design. And so, at the end, I want to show you a graph that actually we worked on very early with colleague Sean Alquist, who's now a professor at Harvard. And we've always had this idea that the way we work in these systems is much like a gear in a motor. And we all have our individual expertise in designing or in mechanical or in material of the system. And we actually, in the field that we work in, need to be critical experts to be able to deal with the complexities that we have to deal with. But at the same time, we are asked to work together and, if possible, all understand the system together. So we always imagine the way we're working, obviously not in a linear way where one designer decides something and hands over information to the other, it's been much more interconnected. And so you can imagine maybe that like cocktails that are dissected, each one is responsible to drive one of the systems to each of the sectors and develop the power through working as a gear. And finally, the message that I've kind of learned in the last couple of projects is that what we can do by approaching problems like this is that we can deal with complexity computationally. But we shouldn't confuse that complexity is something complicated. So things that we design may sometimes look complicated because they're based on the principles of computational means. Actually, they're incredibly simple, and they're just dealing with complexity. And the misleading thing can be that because it's so easy to build complex things with our computational tools, but we shouldn't misuse